Well, good morning, everyone. Very, very warm welcome to you all. We're delighted to see you here. It's a bit of a dreich day outside, but we're really pleased that you are with us, and we trust as we meet together, we'll be encouraged and blessed. Sunday school recommenced this morning, and we're grateful for that. And we assure our Sunday school of our prayers in the time that is to come. We're also delighted to welcome with us this morning Callum Court. Callum is our new youth and family worker. He's going to come up later in the service and answer a few questions for a couple of reasons. First of all, so you can get to know him a wee bit, but also recognize him so that if he calls to see you or is involved with your family or whatever it may be, you'll know who he is and what he's about. Callum's going to be working particularly with our families and our young people in order to encourage and develop that life that we have in Christ. And we trust that he will be blessed as he works with us over these next few years. Just remind a few other announcements. Just remind committee members, if they haven't already done so, to collect the Mall magazine for their district and to deliver them as soon as possible, please. We want to encourage you to return this evening for our evening service. It's at a different time this evening. It's 6:30, 6:30 this evening, and we hope that you'll be able to come and join with us for that. I'll be speaking at that service. We meet for prayer prior to that in the Memorial Hall at 6 o'clock. We're meeting at that time to enable our young folk to head to a new event, which is called Armagh Youth Connect. It's going to be a bi-monthly event in various churches around the Armagh, south from here, area. And the one this evening is going to be at Red Rock, starting at 7:45. It's for all our young folk who are year 8 and above. So if any of our young folk in that age category, we would love to see you, along with all the rest of you, at our evening service at 6:30, and then go together to the event in Red Rock. It should be really encouraging. Pete Wright, who used to be the youth worker in Hill Street congregation, now works with an organization called Growing Young Disciples, is the speaker at that. So come along this evening, all of us, 6:30. Last Wednesday night, we had our first part of Hope Explored. It was a very encouraging start, and we'll be starting again this Wednesday night at 7:30. We're going to meet, have a cup of tea or coffee, and we want to welcome you to come down for that. Maybe come down earlier. The weather wasn't great last Wednesday night. It was raining, but if you want to come down earlier, go for a walk around the mall, come on up in, get a wee cup of tea and join in. That would be great. Can I say that if you haven't been at the first one, that does not mean that you can't come to the next one. You certainly can, and we would love to see you there, as well as the ones who were there already. So that's something I want to encourage you to be a part of on Wednesday evening. The final part will be next week. That's the 27th. Next Sunday, then, our services at our usual times. Well, Sunday school will be at 10:15, services 11:30 and 7 p.m., and we commend those to you. Then finally, it is with deep sadness that we announce the death of Lady Mary Taylor, late of Portadown Road, Armagh, on Monday past the 11th of September. Her funeral service took place here in the Mall on Wednesday, followed by interment at Balnahone Cemetery. To her husband, our esteemed Elder John, and her children, Jane, Jonathan, Rachel, Rowena, Alexandra, and Hannah, and the whole family circle, we extend our sincere sympathy and assure them of our love and our prayers at this time. These are all announcements. Let us worship God. We're going to begin as we sing to God's presence our opening praise, "Be Still for the Presence of the Lord."
Thank you.
Let's turn to God in prayer. Let us all pray. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we have, in opening our praise, we have called on ourselves to be still before you. We recognize and acknowledge this is not to be passive, it is not to be inactive. It certainly doesn't mean that we do not engage with you. But it does mean we wait upon you, assured of your presence, and with the comfort and the encouragement to know that you have promised to be with us by your Spirit, to bless us, to be at work in our lives, to point us to Jesus, and by your Spirit, as your word works in our hearts, to make us to be more like Jesus. So we come, comforted by the knowledge that as we look to you, as we are encouraged in the knowledge of your near presence, that we can worship you to declare your worth, to say that you are God, to say that you're above all things, and that you're the one who is above all things, and in you we have life in all its fullness. We also come to confess our failures, those things we have failed to do that we ought to do, and those things that we have done that we should not do. And we know, God, you know our own hearts. You know the things that we have thought that are wrong, the things that we have said that are wrong, the things that we have done which are wrong. And you also know, O God, how we have failed to think, to say, to do the things that are right. But, Lord, we also come with a great assurance of forgiveness through the finished work of Jesus Christ. We thank you that by his life and death, that he paid for our sins, and that by his resurrection he confirmed not only his authority over death, but his victory over sin and hell itself. And you pour out your love upon us, and you pour out your grace upon us, undeserved, unlooked for, so that we know not only do we come before you now, but we are accepted through Jesus Christ. So, Lord, as we begin a new session here in the Mall, we pray, Lord, that it'll not be a case of routine, but it'll be an excitement and anticipation that you're at work in us corporately and in us individually. And as we are humbled by all your goodness and love, may we respond with joy and with great assurance, because we pray in the lovely name of Jesus. Amen. We turn for our Bible reading this morning to the book of Acts, and we're going to read Acts chapter 8, and beginning at verse 1 through to verse 25. We're going to, in our morning services, return to the book of Acts and see how God is at work in us as the church and what his will is for our lives. Acts chapter 8. And we're beginning at verse 1. This is God's word. And Saul was there giving approval to his, that is, Stephen's death. He had been killed, lynched by those who rejected God's truth. And on that day, a great persecution broke out against the church at Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him. But Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off men and women and put them in prison. Those who had been scattered preached the word wherever they went. Philip went down to a city in Samaria and proclaimed the Christ there. When the crowds heard Philip and saw the miraculous signs he did, They all paid close attention to what he said. With shrieks, evil or unclean spirits came out of many, and many paralytics and cripples were healed. So there was great joy in that city. Now, for some time, a man named Simon had practiced sorcery in the city and amazed all the people of Samaria. He boasted that he was someone great, and all the people, both high and low, gave him their attention and exclaimed, "This man is the divine power, known as the great power." They followed him because he had amazed them for a long time with his magic. But when they believed Philip, as he preached the good news of the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Simon himself believed and was baptized. And he followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and miracles he saw. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. When they arrived, they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not yet come upon any of them. They had simply been baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. When Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money and said, "Give me also this ability, so that everyone in whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." Peter answered, "May your money perish with you, because you thought you could buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord. Perhaps he will forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin." Then Simon answered, "Pray to the Lord for me, so that nothing you have said may happen to me." When they had testified and proclaimed the word of the Lord, Peter and John returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel in many Samaritan villages. And we finish our reading here, and we pray for God's blessing upon it. Now, at this point, I'm going to invite Callum to come on up the front. He's coming up to me, because that's easier than, frankly, me going down there. So come on ahead, Callum. They're steep steps.
They are.
Come on, you stand center stage there so everybody can see you. Now, this is Callum. Callum has come to work with us, for the next few years, and he's going to be involved in our ministry to our young people and our children and to our families, and he will become a familiar part of our life and witness around here. So, Callum, first of all, I just want to welcome you most sincerely and delighted that you have agreed to come and work with us. So, some people here may know you, but maybe you could tell us a wee bit about your family background and how you came to faith.
Yeah, no problem. Yes, good morning, everyone. It's so good to be with you here in the mall. So nice to see all of you finally and be here with you this morning. Yes, my name's Callum. I'm 22 years old. I live with my mum, my dad, and my two brothers, Caleb and Joel. How I came to faith? Yeah, probably many of you here, I was raised in a Christian home, and that's kind of something we maybe gloss over, maybe a wee bit too quickly. I'm very thankful for my mom, my dad, and my grandparents as well, who brought me up in the faith, who taught me the gospel from a very young age, brought me to church so that I could hear about my need for a Savior, my need for King Jesus and his rule in my life. So my parents brought me up in the faith. I came to church from very, very young, and it was probably closer to my later teens that the Lord placed a few men in my life to invest in me. They played football, which really helped. I love playing football. And they invested in me, encouraged me to get involved in church, to serve, opened the Bible with me. And it was really over a period of that time, maybe from 15 to 17 or 18, where I really took my faith more seriously. I would have always professed to be a Christian, but maybe didn't really know what that looked like, I guess, on a daily basis until I was a little bit older. And since then, 17, 18, I've left school, left Portadown College. Maybe there's a few Armagh Royal people in here, but I went to Portadown College, proud Portadown College student, left there, spent some time working in church in Rich Hill Presbyterian as an apprentice there, doing a wee bit of study alongside that as well. So that's kind of me from very young up to date now.
Okay, thanks very much, Callum. I'm not allowed to talk about sport anymore, so. Now you're going to be working part time here, 15 hours a week, thereabouts. So, what else are you doing at present then? Because I'm sure you're not just sitting home on the PlayStation or whatever. So.
So alongside working here 15 hours, I'm also studying down at Union College in Belfast. I'm studying theology there as an undergraduate student. That's my second year, about to start into second year of Union. So I'll be traveling back and forth for study and obviously for being here on weekends and throughout the week as well.
Very good. Thank you. So that'll keep you busy, won't it?
Absolutely.
And we hope that that'll be an encouragement to you. Keep me on my toes of theology. So now, as our youth and family worker, you'll be getting to know leaders, young people, and their families. What is it you hope to achieve, both personally for yourself and for the cause of Christ here in the Mall during your time with us?
Yeah, that's a good question. I hope to learn, I think, number one. I'm still very young. I've never worked as a youth and family worker before, so I've got a lot to learn. A lot to learn from each of you who've been at the Mall for, I'm sure, a long time. I'm excited to learn, to get to know you, you and your families, and whether you're very young or perhaps a bit older here. I'm really excited to get to know you. I'm hoping to learn more about myself as a disciple of Jesus. I trust and pray he is a lot more to teach me and show me about myself, to expose my need for him more and more on a daily basis. I'm also excited to be here in the Mall with new partners in the gospel. As I said, I was in Rich Hill. It's not too far from here, but it's so exciting to get to know a new church family following Jesus as I follow Jesus as well. So what I hope to achieve ultimately is that each of us will grow closer in our knowledge and love of our God. I think that's all he's called us to achieve, is to know him, to follow his son, to know him as he's revealed himself in his word. And I think that's what I want for my heart and for each of us here in the Mall, that we would continue to follow Jesus, to grow closer to his word, and to honor him and live for him in our daily lives.
Well, look, really appreciate that, Callum, and we're looking forward to having you amongst us and working with us. It's a personal encouragement to me to have you here, and we just want to also assure you that we will be praying for you and praying with you, and that as you work in our midst, we trust that the families and so on here will be able to, so when this chap gets in touch with you or calls to your home, whatever it may be, you'll know who he is and you'll be able to welcome him. And are you a tea or a coffee man? Just
either, but probably more coffee than
more
tea.
Proper coffee or?
Oh, anything's good.
That's okay.
Anything's good.
Our former assistant was, shall we say, a very defined coffee drinker.
Well, and, no, I'm not. Anything at all.
That's
good.
Okay. Yeah. That's all right. So, Roberta, you'll still be using the the gold blend or whatever it is, so we're okay. That's great. Look, thank you so much. Thanks, Cal. So I just want to encourage you all to pray for Callum, and it's a daunting enough thing to grow up in one church family and then suddenly be transplanted into another one and try and get to know people. The Mall is regarded, people say, it's a friendly and a welcoming place. I am sure we will show that and prove that day by day as Callum works amongst us. We'll be praying for him and for other aspects of our life in a little while, but now we just want to sing to God's praise. We're going to sing our hymn of the month, God the Uncreated One. I hope now this is the third week that we've been singing it, that we're starting to get to know it a wee bit better. Let us stand and sing praise to our God. Let's continue to worship God as we bring our morning tithes and offerings. Thank you. Let's unite our hearts in prayer. Let's all pray. Our gracious God, we pray this morning for Callum as he begins working with us and among us. We pray for his own walk with you. We pray, O Lord, that you will enable him to stay close to Jesus, and that as he gets to know new folk, that you will bless him in his own life. And we pray that you will enable him to be an example to us all, and that even by his presence and his encouragement, that that will bear fruit in our lives. We pray for his service to Christ's church in this place. And we pray for the lives that he will touch. We pray, our Father, that it will indeed, Lord, be lives that are transformed by your grace. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to bless to all the work and ministries that we're involved in our fellowship. We thank you for Sunday school, which recommenced this morning. We thank you and pray for it, that it'll be a blessing to the children and to our young people. We thank you for Colin, who stepped in as our Sunday school superintendent at the present time. And we pray, O Lord, you will raise up one who will be able to take on this responsibility in short time. We pray for grace in the Bible class as well, and we ask that you will bless the work there amongst our older young people, that it will indeed be a group of folk who will come to faith and grow in faith and be nurtured and encouraged in the things of God. And we pray for all our other activities, uniformed organizations, our Boys Brigade, recommenced Girls Brigade, for all the other things that we're involved in with our children, with our young people, and with older folk too. May these, O God, be transforming, that we will be drawn closer to one another, and especially that we're closer to Jesus. And so we commit these things to you in the name of Jesus. And we pray this morning for those who grieve and mourn most particularly. We pray for the Taylor family, that you will be with them and bless them and bring to them comfort and peace. And for all who mourn the loss of someone, whether it be recently or sometime in the past, may your Spirit bring healing and peace. Because we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We've been reflecting on service and what it means to be serving, and let's think about that as we sing our next praise, "Before You I Kneel," a workers' prayer, after which the young folk can head on out to junior church.
Yeah.
When we took our leave of the Book of Acts at the end of last year, the name of a man who would go on to feature significantly in the ensuing unfolding story of the fledgling New Testament church appeared. And yet it wasn't an auspicious start, because this man was an opponent of the church. This man hated Jesus. The appearance of this man marks a hinge, a turning point in the life of the church, the little fledgling New Testament church. And it begins an expansion of the work of the church in Jerusalem and beyond the city walls. That man is known as Saul. And it's a reminder to us of the truth of Scripture, because had it not been for what we read subsequently from this chapter onward, the appearance of Saul, who appears at the end of chapter 7, the beginning of chapter 8, might simply have been a passing curious detail. Someone who was renowned for his opposition to the gospel. And yet we know how it unfolds, don't we? We know that Saul becomes Paul. Paul is small man. And he becomes a towering figure in the early church. But more importantly, it is a reminder to us that even when things are not what we would want them to be, even if they're not what we would hope them to be, it is a reminder to us that God is in control of all things. For when the Bible says all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose, it is not God making fool of us. It is not God saying something which is not the case. Because the event which Saul, who became Paul, is at the heart of, as it engulfed the church, could have led to its destruction. But instead, it leads to great things. But what I want us to do as we think about that is, and as we return to the Book of Acts for a series of studies over these next few weeks in our mornings, is keep in mind this, that this book, these passages, the events that are recorded for us here, are a reminder to us of what it is to be Christians in an alien culture. Christians in an alien culture. And it doesn't take me to tell you that that is increasingly how it is in our own culture today. For I'm old enough to remember Callum's 22. He's a child. I had my 59th birthday last month. I don't look a day over 58, I know that, but I remember, and many of us will remember, even not all that many years ago, but let's say a quarter of a century ago or more, where the church and where the place of the church was understood at the heart of our society and the heart of our culture and the heart of our community, where people who were involved in the life of the church were recognized and their perspective, their views were taken on board. No longer is that the case. Generally speaking. So how do we live for Jesus in our world that is so changed? And a good place to start is what we read about here. So there was Saul, chapter 8, verse 1, giving approval to the death of Stephen, the first Christian martyr who who died for the faith. And what followed? Well, verses 1 to 4 tells us that what followed was persecution. And how many of us would like to be persecuted? None of us wants to be persecuted. We might say, you've got to be mad to look for that. But the effect of Stephen's murder was to force the church out. The church had been growing and stabilizing and reaching out into all sorts of places within the city of Jerusalem and in its very immediate environs, where there were more and more people, thousands of people, who were coming to faith and who were growing, and the church there had been developing. It had led, for instance, to difficulties in which Christians, and particularly widows, remember back a couple of chapters ago, which we looked at last year, where the widows in the church were being dealt with. Some of them felt unfairly, so they appointed the first church committee, the deacons, who were enabled to distribute the food to those who were in need. And it seemed that the church within Jerusalem was going from strength to strength. And then suddenly persecution struck. The church was pushed out all over the place. When Stephen was killed, it immediately became what one writer has described as centrifugal, where believers were flung away from the city out into the surrounding areas. You know what it's like if you watch athletics on TV and you see the discus throwers or the hammer throwers, and they spin round and round and round, and they let go of the hammer or the discus or whatever it is, and the distances that it flies, are just astonishing. That is that force which is driving it out from the center, from that little place, concrete area where the athletes are spinning round, and they send this thing out. And that is what happened, where the church went out from Jerusalem to the surrounding country. First to Judea, the region round about Jerusalem, but others went further. They ventured to Samaria, and still others went beyond that as well. So when the Bible says all things work together for good to those who love God, God used the death of Stephen, this martyr, to begin the centuries-long process of fulfilling the prophetic words of our Lord that recorded in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, where Jesus said, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." The intense persecution that the church faced at the time of the death of Stephen drove multitudes of believers away from Jerusalem. But Satan's minions were wrong if they thought for a minute that they had silenced the voice of the gospel. As Satan has sought to do time and time and time again down through history, God used the world's evil intentions to accomplish his purposes. Luke tells us that those who had been scattered preached the word wherever they went. And when we put it like that, just read those words in chapter 8, verse 1, it always seems so straightforward, so normal. It's what the church does. But the reality, of course, for believers was anything but normal. For one thing, there was Saul there giving approval to Stephen's death. Saul of Tarsus may not himself have picked up a stone and may not have thrown it at Stephen to kill him in the public lynching of this godly man, but he was there. He was approving of it. He was saying, this is a good thing to do. And his approval wasn't from a safe distance. He was there, and he began there with an active engagement in the persecution of the church. He didn't just look after the clothes of those who laid them at his feet. Here was a man who was driven by religious zeal, was determined to win, to defeat, to drive out the followers of Jesus Christ. But then think of the people who were involved, the Christians who were driven out of the city. Many of them would have lost possessions. Many of them would have found themselves financially in dire straits. They would have gone to places that were not familiar to them. They would have been wondering what is going to happen to them, what is going to happen to their families, where is this all going to lead to? And it's simply in a simple word, the church scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. We put ourselves in the shoes of those people. It was grim. And let's be honest, few of us have ever experienced religious persecution. At worst, we might have had to endure some mockery or some sarcasm, but little more. Some of us might even have found career progression has been frustrated by being a professing Christian. We receive information on a regular basis from the Christian Institute, which has highlighted several cases in recent years of Christians facing illegal action, whether by the police or other statutory bodies, even by charities and employers who have taken action against Christians because they hold to Christian principles. Wouldn't it be very revealing for us if that which was facing the church in Jerusalem was to happen in our lives? How many of us would defect? How many of us would prefer our comforts to serving Jesus Christ? It's sobering, isn't it, to see that the early Christians fled, but they didn't defect. A document written probably by a Christian writer called Tertullian, who lived from round about 155 to 210 AD, it's called Apologeticus, or apology. Apology, in that sense, is not saying sorry. It is a defense of the faith. There's a branch of Christian theology called apologetics, which seeks to do this, to defend the faith, to proclaim this is what we believe and this is why we believe it. It is defending the truth and enabling us to be able to explain it to other people. Tertullian was one of the first apologists, one of the first theologians to engage in apologetics. And in this work, he famously says, "The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church." By this he means that instead of destroying the church, martyrdom, the killing of Christians, produces a greater fruit. The persecution of the church in Jerusalem became a catalyst, a changing point for the advancement of the gospel and the extension of the church, because ordinary Christians, and I put that in quotes, ordinary Christians spread out across Judea and Samaria and further afield. And when they went there, what did they do? Did they keep their heads down? Did they stay silent? Did they simply wait until everything blew over again? No. They continue to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Here is a key lesson for us in our anti-Christian culture in which we live today. To be a Christian, as Paul reminds us, means we believe with our hearts and proclaim with our mouths that Jesus Christ is Lord. If we won't do this when we're under no pressure, what makes us think that we'll suddenly do it when there will be a cost involved? The church faced persecution. But as a consequence of that, a second thing happened, and that was preaching. And by that, I don't just mean this here, standing at the front, proclaiming in a formal setting like this. But one of the scattered preachers was one of the other deacons, one of the colleagues of Stephen who had been put to death. This man was called Philip. And he began telling people about Jesus in the area of Samaria. And God blessed his efforts. God blessed his ministry by making profound influence on what was a very mixed up religious people of that region. Samaritans were and are, continue to be, a group who are descended from Israel, but who rejected any of the other books after the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, the books of Moses. The problem, of course, is when someone rejects any of God's word, then their theology becomes corrupt. There is a misunderstanding of the truth, and ultimately a rejection of the one of whom the Bible speaks, that is Jesus Christ. The Samaritans are still lost in their unbelief. There are a small group of them, mere thousands these days, living around Israel in that part of the world. And in that sense, they're not unlike the society in which we live today. Again, when I was younger, there was an acceptance of Bible knowledge. There was a part of the society in which we lived that people knew their Bibles a bit better. They understood the Bible stories. They'd heard the Bible stories. They grew up with them. Young people went to Sunday school, and they learned these Bible stories. It might not have gone beyond that, but at least they had that foundation. Nowadays, there's a real mess out here in our society where people don't know things or misunderstand things, where faith is a complete mishmash. And how do we communicate the good news to a society that simply doesn't understand the gospel? Well, that was the context in which Philip ministered. He went there and he spoke the truth. He talked about Jesus. He talked about who he was, and he performed many miraculous signs. In the early church, miraculous signs were used by God to establish the church and to guarantee, as it were, and to confirm its authenticity. But in God's grace, through this preaching of the word, a great deal of rejoicing occurred as many people came to believe. Philip wasn't deterred by the lack of understanding of the Samaritans. He had come from Jerusalem, where at least the people had the whole of the Old Testament, and they should have had some understanding of the coming of the Messiah, who he was. There was not that same understanding with the Samaritans. So he wasn't deterred by that. He simply rejected and forgot about this whole notion that Samaritans were unclean, that which would have been a barrier to him. He saw people who were lost. He saw people who needed rescue, and he went to them and he told them about Jesus. Because evangelism is the message of the gospel, the message of Jesus Christ. And we're called in our day and generation to live out the message in our words and in our actions. We're to be kind and gracious and loving and generous and forgiving, but we're also to be clear. Because this world, this society in which we live, doesn't have the foundation that it used to have even 20 or 30 years ago, to expect that how we live our lives will of itself be sufficient for people to understand, it's not going to be the case. We need to make sure that Jesus is our message from our lips as well as from our lives, because he's our hope. So Philip preached Jesus Christ. He ministered to people. He shared with them. And many of the Samaritans perhaps would have been those who remembered the ministry of Jesus when he was amongst them, and therefore they responded with joy. This is an encouragement to us. Sharing the good news isn't easy, but God gives us grace sufficient for the day. And ask him to give you an opportunity tomorrow, when you go to your place of work, or you go into a shop, or wherever it happens to be, as you share this message with others, no matter how unaware they are of Jesus. But that doesn't mean that everything's going to go smoothly all the time, because the majority of this section, for verse 9 through to 25, talks about phoniness. Because among those who professed faith and were baptized was a well-known magician called Simon. Now, Simon's profession of faith appeared to be genuine, but later events show that it was actually quite spurious. He showed a great deal of eagerness because he followed Philip everywhere. He appeared to have been motivated by a desire to learn and to grow. But it was actually, he was motivated more by his desire to acquire the miraculous power that he had seen demonstrated by him. And when the apostles who had remained in Jerusalem following Stephen's death heard that there was an outpouring of God's Spirit, that the work of the gospel in the Samaritan area had proven fruitful, they sent Peter and John to pray for them, that they might receive the Holy Spirit. I wonder, when Peter and John arrived there, what went through John's mind as he laid his hands on these people, saw the Spirit come upon them, just as he had upon those in Jerusalem? Don't forget, not all that long before, he and his brother James had asked permission from Jesus to call down fire from heaven to destroy some Samaritans who had not welcomed them. You can read about that in Luke chapter 9, verse 54. So he probably understood, maybe for the first time, why the Lord had rebuked him then. John surely sensed keenly the reason why apostolic authority was needed. Why did they have to come and lay their hands for the Holy Spirit to come upon these people? After all, did they not respond? Well, these were Samaritans. These were outsiders. These were unclean. These were not people who were Jews. So it required the authenticating acknowledgement of the work of the apostles, the founders, we might say, of the church, to come and to lay their hands on the people. If anyone else had done it, then there would have been a rift, a continued separation between the Jews and the Samaritans, who, yes, were Christians, but that might never have been healed. There might have been two branches of the church. But because Peter and John came, laid their hands, effected the blessing of God, this was a unifying factor, that salvation knit together two groups. It's why the Spirit came in that way at that occasion. But that dramatic descent of the Holy Spirit propelled this man, Simon, to reveal his true colors. How did he respond? He offered Peter and John money and demanded, "Give me also this ability so that everyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit. I give you money, you give me that power." Peter's response was characteristically blunt. "May your money perish with you, because you thought you could buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry because, why? Your heart is not right before God." And that is the key. Simon hadn't responded to the gospel because he had not genuinely believed. It was demonstrated in how he lived his life. It demonstrated in how he spoke because his heart wasn't right. Because out of the heart comes forth what is on our souls and so on. It is out of our hearts that we express our lives. For Simon, the Holy Spirit was for selfish gain. His understanding of the gospel was so far off that he actually thought that he could purchase it. Peter had rightly recognized Simon as someone who was an opponent instead of a disciple. And he spoke the truth that would meet his real need. Because Peter said to him, "Repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord. Perhaps he will forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. For I see that you're full of bitterness and captive to sin." His heart wasn't right. Instead, it was full of bitterness and was captive to sin. Simon's answer to Peter leaves us with doubt about whether he had a genuine desire to escape the consequences of behavior, whether he truly repented. The Lord knows that. So how can we spot a phony profession of faith? More importantly, perhaps, how do we understand whether our own profession of faith is genuine or phony? Well, the first thing that we need to understand is the centrality of Jesus. If our faith or the faith of another is about anything else, then we've missed the point. The central focus of our worship, of our instruction, of our fellowship, of the expression of our lives must be Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Our profession of faith is not about us. It's about Him. It's about giving Him glory. We know our own hearts. Where is our hope? How are we expressing our faith? The second thing that we need to understand is the liberating power of the work of the Holy Spirit. If the work of the Spirit is going on in our lives, then He points us to Jesus. It's there we find freedom. It is there we find freedom from the guilt and the power of sin, where we're set free to live for Jesus. When the Holy Spirit comes to our lives, it isn't for selfish purposes. It is for others and for the glory of God. And salvation brings joy. Now, joy is not dependent on our circumstances. Don't forget, these are people who have been persecuted and have been driven from their homes, and yet they still have joy. We do not become those who are captives to the flesh. We become joyous servants of Jesus Christ. The contrast with phony faith is obvious. Simon sought to exalt himself rather than Jesus. In this, he demonstrated a preoccupation with the material rather than with the spiritual. In phony Christianity, you'll hear a lot about money, you'll hear a lot about position, you'll hear a lot about power. Authentic Christianity is about our walk with God, about glorifying Christ. True Christianity, physical things serve spiritual purposes. As we seek to live our lives for Jesus in this alien culture in which we find these days, all of us need to examine our own hearts, ask ourselves, where am I spiritually? What is my motivation? Have I come in faith? And is it to glorify God? And if we have, may we rejoice in the freedom that we have to honor Christ and bring glory to his name. Let's pray. Our gracious God and Father, we give you thanks for Jesus, the one who has saved us and the one who has called us. May we find his Spirit at work in our lives to bring glory to his name. Amen. Let's reflect upon that as we sing our final praise from the breaking of the dawn. The very God of peace sanctify you wholly and preserve you blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.